I would like to welcome everyone to today's Oxford Brain Diagnostics seminar. And in a moment, I'm going to introduce our guest speaker, Professor Giovanni Frisoni. But first, I just wanted to provide a kind of introduction, Giovanni, from us to the company, now that most of us are here online with you today. So OBD is working to change how people think about brain health, and we're using a technology that takes measures of the brain from MRI based on changes in cellular structure. And our goal is to work with researchers and pharma and biotech supporting drug development, but also we're aiming to help clinicians give more personalized care, helping with diagnosis of Alzheimer's and dementia and other brain disorders. So that's a sort of a potted summary of what our goals and what our purpose is. And I'll hand over to you in just a moment. So basically, I'm delighted to have Professor Frisoni join us today. Professor Frisoni is Professor of Clinical Neuroscience at the University of Geneva. He's Director of the Memory Clinic at the Geneva University Hospital and also Consultant at the Fatebenefratelli Hospital, Brescia, Italy, which I hope I said just about right. And today I think we're hoping to learn a bit about your work, Giovanni, around obviously dementia, but also maybe you'll touch on the roadmap initiative for the development of biomarkers that can be used in a kind of real world clinical practice as well. So with that, I'll hand over to you if you'd like to share your screen.
Yes, thank you, Steve. Thank you for the invitation. And yes, I believe that there is more than one line of research that we're carrying on in Geneva that might be of interest to Oxford Diagnostics. However, I have chosen to focus on the roadmap. It seems to me that that's the most pertinent. Although there's another line of research on prevention that you may be interested in, but we can leave some space for the question and answer session. Okay, so about this roadmap, these are the topics or the items that I will try and address. Item number one: what does it take to make a valid biomarker for Alzheimer's disease? Number two is the effort that we did to develop a framework that helps biomarker scientists to validate biomarkers as in a similar way as we validate drugs for clinical use today or in the past the way we've done in the past decades for drugs, but we're still not doing for biomarkers. Then I will tell you something about the roadmap for biomarker validation that we've developed and that we've called Geneva, because the initial workshop was held in Geneva, like many international initiatives. And then there's been a couple of early adopters. One has been amyloid PET, and another one has been tau PET and blood-based biomarker. Now, the reasoning for the roadmap starts from an observation, from a clinical observation, that the reimbursement of Alzheimer's biomarkers in Europe is extremely heterogeneous. This is taken from a Lancet Neurology, our Lancet Neurology paper, where you see the different biomarkers, MRI, FDG PET, amyloid PET, and CSF biomarkers, and the practices for reimbursement practices in some European countries. And as you can see here, some biomarkers in some countries are reimbursed with some limitations. In some countries, some biomarkers are not or were not reimbursed at all. This table dates back in 2017. Something might be changed now, but still, the scenario is far from homogeneous. Why is reimbursement of biomarkers so variable? If you think of if you make a parallelism with the drugs, antihypertensive drugs, they're reimbursed all over Europe. There's no variability. Anti-oncology drugs, they're reimbursed all over Europe. There's some heterogeneity in the most expensive ones, in the new biologics, but they're available all over the place. Why are biomarkers for Alzheimer's? Why do biomarkers for Alzheimer's that cost much, much less treated in such a heterogeneous way by the different countries? Well, one of the possible answers is that we're not developing biomarkers in the appropriate fashion. How are drugs developed? Well, we all know about the clinical phases for drug development, from the preclinical phase to phase one, on testing of the drug on healthy volunteers, on phase two, on testing the drug on patients with a target disease to test the safety and the early efficacy, and phase three, the regulatory phase three trials for where you test primarily efficacy. And then there's a surveillance phase four trials. We don't have something like that in the biomarker space. Every group developing biomarker develop their own program for validation, depending on what they have available. If they have clinical data, they tend to do clinical studies. If they have animal facilities, they tend to do animal preclinical studies. If they have pre-existing epidemiological data, they use historical data. If they don't have historical data, they have just new data on new patients, they use those. So, but there's no structured framework such as the one that we use for drugs. And however, we know that there's at least three phases of validity that each biomarker should go through. The first is analytical validity. I know that I'm speaking to ears that are very sensitive and that are more educated than probably myself on this issue. But just to recap, the first is analytical validity. The biomarker must measure what it is supposed to measure, which is not so obvious. The second is clinical validity. The biomarker must identify a disorder, a disease, and it must be able to separate those with the disease from those without the disease. This is the clinical validity. And then you have the clinical utility. To what extent the use of biomarker impacts on patient management and patient health and patient health related outcomes. That's the clinical utility. Clinical validity is more related to processes and clinical utility to patient outcome. And the threshold for reimbursement of drugs is phase three trial. The threshold for biomarkers, well, it depends. It's fuzzy in different in the US is pretty different from Europe, but it's much more fuzzy. And of course, the fuzziness that we as scientists have in the development doesn't make things easier. It doesn't help to promote our biomarkers with health payers. The idea of developing a structured framework for biomarker development is not something, is not an idea that we had. It's not so regional. Someone else a number of years ago already had this idea in the oncology space. This group of oncologists, some of whom took part to the Geneva initiative on Alzheimer's biomarkers, developed a five-phase biomarker development framework consisting of a phase one of a preclinical exploratory studies, a phase two of clinical assay development for clinical disease, a phase three of retrospective longitudinal repository studies. Phase two is basically case control studies, okay? Where you try and test the accuracy of the biomarker to separate cases from control. Phase three is a phase where you go bigger and you test the accuracy of the biomarker on large populations, possibly testing the earliest stages of the disease, the accuracy of the biomarker for the earliest stages of the disease. Don't forget that this has been developed by oncologists who have biobanks of blood banks of patients who have been followed for a long period of time. So they have blood and clinical information, and this has been developed mainly for blood biomarkers for oncology. And then you have the phase four, where you take new patients, not historical databases. You take new patients, you use the biomarker, and you test the accuracy of the biomarker to detect the disease in the earliest possible stages. And then finally, you have what they call disease control studies, which is the clinical usefulness stage, where you test the impact on health, on patient health outcome. And also, and this is also the phase of health technology assessment, cost utility analysis and cost benefit analysis. So what we did was, of course, this is an extremely concise summary. For each of these phases, each phase is exploded in a number of aims and sub-aims that we have taken, we have adopted and or borrowed. We have borrowed and adapted to the Alzheimer's space. And this is the result of this workshop that we've done in Geneva, where these guys have taken part, and which gave as a product this paper, which is the adaptation of the five-phase biomarker development framework developed by oncologists, adapted to Alzheimer's. The biomarkers that we took into consideration at that time, in 4 years ago, 2017, it was 2016, published in 2017, but the effort was done 5 years ago in 2016, were MRI in terms of atrophy, just atrophy. And within atrophy, hippocampal atrophy, FDG PET, amyloid PET, and specifically one if I'm not mistaken, just one fluorinated agent, just flurbetapir and C11pib, and three, four biomarkers, CSF biomarkers, Aβ42, the ratio Aβ42 and Aβ40, total tau and hyperphosphorylated tau. And let me now show you the Lancet Neurology paper, because the tables are pretty large and, okay, it should be here. Let me stop sharing and reshare this. This is, I don't know if it's large enough for you.
Yeah, let's see.
This is the adaptation of the, is the translation of the oncology framework to our field. You can see on the left, the phase one with the preclinical exploratory studies, and then the phase two, phase three, four, five. And for each, if we omitted the phase one, which is the one, the phase on preclinical studies, phase two is subdivided in a primary aim and a number of secondary aims. Let's go through the primary and secondary aims of phase two. I'm not sure that it's worth going through everything because it's going to be boring, but just to give you the feeling of what this is about, the primary aim of phase two is to estimate the frequency of true positive and false positive and assess the ability to distinguish individuals with and without Alzheimer's dementia. The secondary aims are, number one, to optimize the procedures for assays and their reproducibility within and between laboratories. Number two, to determine the relation between phase one biomarker measurements made in tissue and those made in the phase two studies. In other words, to see to what extent the preclinical measurements map onto the clinical measurements. Number three, to assess the effects of covariates, variables associated with biomarker status or concentration in controls that might require to adjust the thresholds for normality, for instance. And number four, to assess variables, especially disease characteristics associated with biomarker status or level, comorbidity. There may be conditions associated vascular, cerebrovascular disease that may require to do a different reading of the biomarker. And I'm not sure that we want to go through all of them, but you get the feeling. So what we did next was, and I'm sharing again. The PowerPoint presentation. What we did next was to transfer to advance the development of one of these biomarkers, just one, but to advance the development of one of these biomarkers based on the roadmap. And the biomarker that we chose for a number of reasons of opportunity was amyloid PET. So if we take amyloid PET and we go through the different stages briefly, the phase one, this is a slide that we did in 2017, if I'm not mistaken. In 2017, phase one was completed for amyloid PET. Why? Well, because we knew already that some fluorinated biomarkers could label plaques, amyloid plaques in animal. And this was clear. So this phase was completed for amyloid PET biomarkers. Then phase two, I will not go into the secondary aim. Let me just describe the primary aim. At that time, phase number two, the primary aim of phase number two was also completed, because we knew that in humans, the uptake of the tracer was associated with the number of plaques in the brain. And we also knew that the uptake, the positivity or negativity of amyloid PET could distinguish very accurately with high sensitivity and specificity patients with Alzheimer's dementia from healthy controls. So phase two was also completed. That was clear. The literature was adamant on that. Phase number three. Phase number three is the detection ability of amyloid PET in the early phase. And that was pretty clear also. I had to move the window where I see all of you to the left. And that was also taken care of. There had already been a number of studies showing that amyloid PET was able to predict the development of dementia in patients with MCI, with mild cognitive impairment. So fine, that was checked already. That cell was ticked, was checked. And the effect size was also pretty good. So fine. What was not clear at all at that time was the accuracy of amyloid PET in the real life, in real world. There were a number of case series in convenience samples, but there was not a clinical trial in patients representative of the clinical practice. So what did we do? Well, we had the opportunity to build a clinical trial, which has been, and we were lucky enough to have a large funding from the Europe, from IMI, and IMI meaning the European Commission and tracer developer. And we developed a clinical trial, a diagnostic clinical trial to test the accuracy, added value of amyloid PET in the diagnostic confidence of Alzheimer's dementia. These are the centers that have been taking part to this trial. This trial is next to completion, by the way, but we don't have the final, the top line results yet. This is the design of the study. This is a complicated slide, which shows you, which gives you a couple of major main messages. The main message, one of the main, of the two main messages is that the trial has been designed onto the clinical routine. So we've taken the diagnostic workflow, the normal, the regular diagnostic workflow of patients in European memory clinics, which is what you see here in green, okay, with a first consultation, then you do additional diagnostic tests, you discuss the results of the first wave of tests, you do a second, if needed, you do a second wave of a diagnostic test, and then you revise the diagnosis and you define a management plan. This is the diagnostic workflow in virtually all academic memory clinics in Europe. On this workflow, we grafted the clinical trial. And the clinical trial is organized in a regular clinical trial with the screening, with the first visit, with randomization, with the first assessment at 3 months, second assessment at 6 months, a regular clinical trial, but grafted onto clinical practice. And in this clinical trial, we have three arms. We have arm one, where amyloid PET is performed as early as possible over the workflow, along the diagnostic workflow. Amyloid PET is done as early as possible. Then we have arm two, where amyloid PET is not made available until month nine. So in arm two, the patients are treated as usual, because amyloid PET at the time was not available for clinical purposes nowhere in Europe. So arm two is the regular clinical routine. And arm three is the so-called free choice arm. The physician could choose whenever, could choose to have the patient undergo amyloid PET whenever he felt appropriate. Early on, after MRI, after CSF, after FDG PET, or never. And the primary endpoint is the one that you can read here, the difference at 12 weeks, after 3 months, between arm one and arm two in the percentage of patients with a diagnosis made with high confidence. In other words, we tried to see whether the availability of amyloid PET early on in the diagnostic process allowed physicians to issue a diagnosis with a high confidence more often than without amyloid PET. And then there's a number of secondary endpoints that you can read yourself, time to communicate the diagnosis, the changes of the diagnosis, the number of patients entering these trials for disease modifiers, change in the management plan, change of drugs, cholinesterase inhibitors, anti-dementia drugs, or other drugs, and a number of health economic outcomes. The top line results will be available in Q3 this year. Then, Valentina, when we did the original exercise, tau PET and the blood-based biomarkers were not available. Now they are, as you know. And Valentina Garibotto, who is the nuclear medic in Geneva, organized a workshop similar to the original one that we did on the roadmap to try and map the maturity of tau PET and blood-based biomarker onto the five-phase framework. And this generated the six papers, one on tau ligands of the THK family, one on methodological issues, one on blood biomarkers of amyloidosis and tauopathy, another one on CSF, and this is an update on CSF, on the traditional CSF biomarkers, another one on second generation PET tracer, and another one specifically on the the first fluorinated tracer for humans for toxicity. So I will stop here. These are my conclusions that you can read yourself. I believe that if we all as biomarker developers use a common framework to develop our biomarkers, that will facilitate not only the individual biomarkers, but it will facilitate the field overall. Okay, well, this is kind of obvious. We've used the roadmap already for amyloid PET, because there was the interest from companies, from tracer developers, to test their product. But of course, if someone else has a different biomarker, the roadmap can be used and applied to any biomarker. And I believe that in the biomarker space, those in the tau PET and blood biomarker area are already uptaking the roadmap as a reference to promote the development of their biomarkers and the reimbursement the reimbursement by health payers. And this is about it. And I am open to your questions.
That's great. Thank you very much, Giovanni. That was an excellent overview. I think it's a reminder. We've circulated some of your papers internally, but it's a reminder to have a look at the detail of the roadmap and the background to it as well, which was very useful. Thanks. I'm sure we'll have a few questions. I mean, I'm going to be greedy because I'm chairing, so I can dive in straight away. And I took a few notes. I guess one question related to the idea of the model being that we have different phases of trial structure, which is the typical pathway for drug development. And as you said, it tends to be phase three at which is the point of sort of proving in terms of reimbursement and that kind of thing. I wondered if you think that there's an equivalent sort of stage that you would say is useful in the diagnostic space, and perhaps if you can consider it, if that is the same or different for both, say, reimbursement, but also for kind of regulatory purposes as well.
Well, for regulatory purposes, I believe that the bar for biomarkers is pretty low. I'm sure that you know this stuff much better than I do, but from what I understand, the bar for having a biomarker registered, approved for clinical use, you simply have to show that the biomarker is supposed to measure, it measures what it's supposed to measure, period. Reimbursement, the bar is going to be significantly higher, and there's no threshold. The threshold will be different for different biomarkers. It will basically, from what I observe is that the most expensive, the more expensive a biomarker is, the higher the bar. For amyloid PET, regulators are placing a lot of hurdles, which has not been the case for blood biomarkers for oncology, for instance. The price is relatively low. PSA for prostate cancer costs how much? I don't know, $10 per. You know, with PET, it's going to cost $1,500, so the bar is going to be higher, and they are asking for more evidence. But if you provide structured evidence, your case will be stronger. And this is exactly the reasoning of GE and Life Molecular Imaging, who are taking part to the Amipad clinical trial.
Yeah. Okay, that's good. I'm going to open it up to the rest of the group. I've got more questions, but would anyone else like to ask something?
Yeah, I'll go if that's all right, Stephen.
Sure.
Hi. So I'm wondering, the sort of ground truth when it comes to AD, and you referred to this, I think, in one of the initial slides, that pathology is the preferred sort of metric, but understanding that that's very hard to get hold of, but that sort of clinician diagnosis is used as a ground truth for what's actually happened. It does seem that we're relying on pretty muddy markers already. It's difficult for clinicians to make judgments, and cognitive tests can be flawed. I was wondering how big a problem you think that is, and whether you have any feelings about what mitigates that problem.
What you're saying is, I believe, only partially true, Ian, because of course you need pathology for an etiological diagnosis. If you want to label a patient as Alzheimer's, you must have evidence of amyloid and tau. However, if you have, don't do the mistake of thinking that pathology is the holy grail for clinicians. I don't know how familiar you all are with the ATN framework. Please, Cliff Jackson, you know that, right? Okay. Now, there's two different views of Alzheimer's in the scientific space. One is Cliff Jack's view and co-authors, where pathology defines the disease. In that case, yes, you have the pathology, you know everything you need to know. Then you can do the staging, but the staging you can do it with the MMSE, with the CDR, with neuropsychological tests. Well, that's relatively trivial. There's another view, however. The other view is the one that we have in Europe, Bruno Dubois, myself, and others, that we have expressed in the criteria that we've published last week in the Lancet Neurology, where Alzheimer's is pathology plus symptoms, plus cognitive impairment. If you have pathology only, you are at risk. If you have pathology and no cognitive impairment, you may be at risk of developing Alzheimer's dementia, but you don't have Alzheimer's disease. You have a brain at risk. This is radically different because it includes the notion of neurodegeneration, which is much more related to clinical symptoms than pathology. There's plenty of people with pathology with no sign of neurodegeneration. But when you have symptoms, you do have neurodegeneration. So what you're developing on MRI fits very nicely the way of thinking that we have in Europe, where a marker of neurodegeneration can be very useful to substantiate that a patient with cognitive impairment and amyloid and tau has cognitive impairment due to amyloid and tau and not to other things. I try to give you an example. We know that there's plenty of older persons aged 60 and over who have amyloid and tau in their brain and function perfectly. Okay, fine. We also know that there's plenty of people with MCI out there who do not have amyloid and tau pathology. They have MCI. MCI, you know, MCI is a clinical, is a statistical construct. They have MCI because they're depressed, because they are taken, because they've always had a low cognitive performance since age 20. When they're age 60, they're not going to improve. Because they take 25 drugs, because they have a polymorbidity, because they have take drugs and they have also vascular disease. And you can very well imagine that the two things, the two occurrences occur together. In other words, you can have persons with amyloid and tau with them who also have MCI, which is unrelated to amyloid and tau. And that's not Alzheimer's dementia. That's a brain at risk for Alzheimer's disease who accidentally also has mild cognitive impairment. What do you need to state that a patient with MCI and amyloid and tau has MCI due to amyloid and tau? But you need a marker of neurodegeneration, which is what you guys develop. And the marker of neurodegeneration, it must be a marker of neurodegeneration specific with the specific topography of Alzheimer's, of course. With the topography, it must be in line with the clinical symptoms. We know that neurodegeneration maps onto clinical symptoms, right?
Perfect, thank you.
Lovely, thanks very much. Yeah, go ahead, Jed.
A brief follow-up question, actually, because you were talking about MCI and including mentioning MCI in the absence of amyloid and tau. And I just wanted to ask how helpful you find the distinction between amnestic and non-amnestic MCI.
Poorly. Well, no, not poorly. It's of some help. Honestly, in clinical practice, you often see non-amnestic MCI are more often than non-Alzheimer's type. But the uncertainty in the clinic is so high that you're not going to rely on the clinical phenotype, on the neuropsychological phenotype. Mm-hmm. Especially when you have the possibility of having biomarkers, you don't rely on the neuropsychological phenotype.
That's interesting. Can I just quickly ask, I mean, in the AmiPad trial, are you making the distinction at all?
We have that variable. We've not analyzed that yet because it's not one of the primary and secondary endpoints, but we have that.
Okay.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, please. Steven, go ahead.
I was going to also be greedy, Giovanni, if you don't mind. I have a couple of questions. Firstly, it's fascinating to see your strategic roadmap, and I kind of agree that there needs to be structure and coherence in the biomarker space so that we all, folks who are in the biomarker space, go through a particular process. Could you add any thoughts on the timeline from phase one to phase five? Because for me, you know, there's a sense of urgency in the Alzheimer's community, right? It's been 2 decades and we still don't have new drugs coming out and quite a high failure rate. So the more sense of urgency we have, maybe perhaps it might be a good thing without compromising scientific ethics and diligence as we do things to a very, very high standard. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, how long did it take to have an amyloid PET validated?
Yeah.
15 years? When was the original paper by Annette and Arbery? Was it 2003 or 2004?
Early 2000. 2000. That was my first thought. So I don't know if you do have those thoughts. I mean, it would be great. I mean, you know, my worry, both from a personal and maybe perhaps a professional point of view, also is that you know, there's a lot of biomarkers today. There were a lot of biomarkers in the past, and no doubt there'll be a few other folks who will be doing, you know, aggressive research into bringing out new biomarkers for AD. So that's the sense of urgency. And my second question was, you know, I would love to see, I suppose, as we look at clinical trials, both in the past and today, the ones that are in phase one and phase two, especially, you know, one day for a neurodegeneration biomarker to become a clinical primary endpoint. Do you see that also, or is it, you know, it will always stay in the secondary space or an exploratory space? Because we have cognitive tests and cognitive assessments occupying primary endpoint on a lot of the clinical trials in AD right now. And we know what the shortcomings are with those neuropsychiatric tests.
I believe that a neurodegenerative biomarker would be the prime candidate in a disease-modifying clinical trial. Much more than amyloid and tau. Much more than amyloid, for sure. No doubt on that. Probably even more than tau. Most likely even more than tau. The problem with the neurodegenerative biomarkers is that what we have today, whole brain atrophy and hippocampal atrophy, have been so disappointing. They go in the opposite direction that they're supposed to go in when you give an anti-amyloid drug. So it's been before the paradoxical result with the vaccine structural MR was in pole position as a surrogate endpoint, because what we're referring to is a surrogate endpoint. And structural MR was in pole position. Now, after what happened, it failed. But there's neurofilament light now. And neurofilament light is the new neurodegenerative biomarker, which is in pole position. And it's up to you guys to take, to replace neurofilament light as the in the pole position neurodegenerative biomarker.
That's a clear challenge. Thanks for that, Giovanni. Actually, a supplementary question in relation to the use of structural imaging till now, as you say, in your summary of the roadmap, you referred to hippocampal volume, but I noticed I don't think total or whole brain volume was, or whole cortical gray matter volume or anything was listed there. Was there a reason for that? Can I ask?
I think that the reason was for because we had to focus on to limit the number of measures.
Sure.
For reasons of resources, of available resources, to do the survey of the literature, which has been extremely time consuming.
Hmm. Okay, yeah. So hippocampal volume, I guess, that would come first on the list, and maybe the whole brain second. So that, in terms of priority. Yes, go ahead.
Related follow-up to that. So I've seen a few papers recently moving from hippocampal volume to cortical thickness in so-called AD signature regions. I've seen papers from Cliff Jack and papers from the UCL group focusing on that metric. Do you think that is likely to kind of replace hippocampal volume in terms of the kind of primary kind of volumetric or macrostructural measure?
It might. The problem I see is again the lower the wound in terms of credibility of structural MR. Lately, drug companies, pharma companies are reluctant to use MR, structural MR, however measured as an outcome for disease modifiers.
Yeah, I'd like to ask a couple more quick questions about that, actually. So one question is about the interpretation of those changes. So as you say, some of the anti-amyloid trials have seen worsening atrophy. And there's been some debate about, you know, is that actually the loss of amyloid somehow is related to a volume loss? And other people have argued that the numbers don't add up in terms of the volume occupied. It can't be that explanation. What kinds of other things could it be? Could you comment on that? Do you think there are, you know, do we have some hints of what might be happening, or is it something that's quite poorly understood at the moment?
Well, what we know is that anti-amyloid drugs attack amyloid in the vessel. That's sure. If you attack amyloid in the vessels, the fluids in the brain are going to be, they rebalance. How do they do that? I have frankly no idea. But I believe it's a fluid shift due to some endothelial dysfunction, endothelial damage or change that takes place following the anti-amyloid attacking vascular amyloid. That would be my first guess.
Is there another question, Jed?
A somewhat related question, I guess, about whether the sense that structural MRI is no longer so appealing for these trials, is that specific to the use of volumetric MRI? Is there a sense that people are still open-minded about microstructural MRI, either through diffusion or other kind of quantitative MRI that might reflect other microstructural properties?
Yes, I believe it's specific to volumetric MRI. I've never had the feeling the credibility wound extends beyond that. Actually, there's no reason why it should.
Except human nature, sometimes just by association, things can suffer, right? Any other questions?
Yeah, I've got a question.
Sure, Jamie.
So my question would just be on the concept of cognitive reserve and how significant you feel that might be in kind of monitoring people who have not converted between stages of AD and neurodegeneration, and measuring that?
Well, you know, cognitive reserve is a conceptual construct. We do not have markers of cognitive reserve. We have proxies, education. But we don't have markers. So we detect the effect of cognitive reserve indirectly. When you see that a patient has amyloid tau and some signs of neurodegeneration and still has no cognitive impairment, well, that might be a sign of cognitive reserve.
Sure.
But there's no direct measure. And it's usually, it's not taken into account neither in clinical trials nor in biomarker development. It might be taken into account. It should be taken into account when you set a threshold of normality. It might be.
Okay. Thank you.
Can I ask a question? Because I'm trying to understand the area more. So if someone starts at a higher level, their cognitive impairment takes them down. So they are impaired, but compared to the average, they're still above the average. So they pass all the tests, but they are actually impaired. So in an ideal world, would you have a cognitive test that's specific for each person? Because in addition to the problem before, you said, it depends on what you set the levels at.
Yes, absolutely. What we do in the clinic is to try and reconstruct the trajectory of the patient. history taking is a reconstruction of the trajectory of the patient, lacking a neuropsychological assessment previous to your assessment. And the correction for agent education tries to take into account some of the variability, but of course it doesn't take into account all the variability between subjects. And indeed, what you're saying is absolutely the case. There's some persons with cognitive performance within normal limits for even taking into account agent education, which, however, are declining. What tells you that? Well, oftentimes it's history. Talking to the patient and talking, but we have no other. There's a number of, well, you know, of the initiatives with the digital biomarkers, wearable devices that are supposed to give exactly what you're saying, a tracking. You monitor your activity, the way you type on your smartphone, starting from age 60. And that might alert you to the onset of cognitive impairment much earlier than a snapshot with the current neuropsychological testing allows to do.
So we're almost out of time, but I know Mario had his hand up. So I think we'll give the last question to Mario, if that's okay.
Yeah, just a quick question. Do you think we are ready for a large and real usage of biomarkers in clinical practice? By which I mean, are the current biomarkers valid and robust enough to help clinicians? And do you think that currently available biomarkers could be realistically used in a large number of hospitals and not just in a small number of excellent sites worldwide?
Well, there's some biomarkers, the answer is yes. CSF markers, for instance, yes, they're feasible. It's easy, lumbar puncture is easy to do, it's cheap. There's some resistance from the patients, but you can overcome that quite easily with some campaign on culture, on some awareness raising and that kind of stuff. The PET biomarkers is more complicated because they're expensive. They're pretty expensive, but that's the only limitation. Only limitation is cost, but not technical feasibility or availability. There's a large number of PET scanners in the Western world. So I believe that we are ready for large scale implementation if someone is ready to pay.
And the last very quick question is different markers can provide complementary information and is essential to combine this information together with clinical demographic data. Do you think that AI can be trusted to perform this combination, providing clinicians with a composite score? Or do you think that clinicians will prefer to have only the raw biomarkers and use their clinical reasoning and judgment to combine the information?
Very good question, Mario. Clinicians are usually reluctant to use black boxes. Unless they're very strongly persuaded that the black box works. MR is a black box after all, because what we see is a nice image which is a reconstruction of the brain, but it's something that has nothing to do, physically has nothing to do with the brain. But the problem I see with artificial intelligence is that you need to train algorithms with large data sets, which we do not have. This is the problem. But we're collecting them. So in a few years' time, it will be possible to train AI algorithms on biomarkers, and that might help physicians. And at the beginning, you know, it's like for every tool, every diagnostic tool. In the early days, you use it, you give a look at the result, and you believe it 10%, then you believe 20%, and then once you see that it's reliable and invalid, well, you use it all the time.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yes, great. Well, I think, sorry, Michele, I think we're going to have to close it there just in the interest of keeping to a schedule. Sorry about that. Clearly, the conversation could go on. It's a good place to end. I agree that it will definitely take more time to collect the big data sets needed for AI to really gain traction, I think, independently, certainly to the extent that it gives confidence to clinicians. But I'm pleased also to end on the thought that there's optimism that we're ready to go to adopt biomarker use as long as someone will pay, which I think was your remark just then, Giovanni. But thank you for the clear challenge you've set us for establishing a good neurodegeneration marker. And thank you very much for your time speaking to all of us today. And I look forward and hope to talk to you in a few weeks' time again.
Sure. Thanks. Thanks, everybody. Thanks, Stephen. Thanks, everybody, for listening
Thank
to me so and for the challenging questions. I enjoyed them all.
Great. Thanks for your time, Giovanni.
Take care. Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Thank you.